Good afternoon. You know, the sessions after lunch, soon after lunch, are always a little precarious, right? Lots of people are, you know, had a good meal and it's not a great time. But what we're hoping to do over the next 45 minutes is just take you through a perspective on personalization, increasingly how brands and marketers will look at personalization, but more importantly, trying to get the whole customer perspective first. What is it about personalization that the customer seeks and wants from brands? And what are those little eerie bits that customers feel a little uncomfortable with, right? When personalization gets onto you and, you know, kind of invades your privacy. And there's a very fine line. And we're going to talk about that because we've got a, you know, pretty diverse panel. There's Vipul from Gaana, so he'll talk about the whole idea of, you know, music streaming and how they use personalization. We have Varun from Zoomcar, which is like the Avison and you know, of India. So effectively how you can have your car experience personalized and how they're using data in a big way. And of course, Piyush, who heads the entire data platform at MakeMyTrip and the whole travel space. So that's really how we're going to play this out. I'm going to ask Deepak to just play a couple of slides to set the tone for what we're about to discuss. Do I have a clicker? Okay, here we go. Yeah, so really, essentially, what we're going to tackle is really what is personalization, right? And what we're saying is personalization is all about how relevant I am across all interactions to my customer, right? How is it that I can present myself in a manner that's relevant to him? So it really enhances his experience, whether it's his buying experience, whether it's his shopping experience. It's really that's one aspect. And there was a survey done in terms of what do customers value the most. Two big things. One is convenience, and the other is personalization, right? Everyone wants it convenient, and everyone wants it personalized. So it's really designed to take into account the user's own perspective. Just a quick overview on what shoppers really want from personalized marketing. I think the first thing they really want is relevant recommendations, things that they wouldn't have thought of for themselves, right? Some of us experience it in our online shopping experiences. But effectively, we have to recognize in an omni-channel world, that's the same expectation we have even while we are shopping in the real world. When you walk into a store, you've got your smartphone on you. Is there something within the store ambience that can direct you into areas of interest? Talk to me when I'm in shopping mode, right? You don't want to get those shopping messages when you're in the middle of work, but there are times when you're out with the family on the weekend, that's where you want to be spoken with, and that's moments which are critical. Remind me of things I want to know but might not be keeping track of, right? How many guys here forget their anniversaries, right? It's good to get a reminder a week in advance, make a reservation at a restaurant of your choice, buy flowers for your partner. I think that's important. Know me no matter where I interact with you, right? We don't want this seamless, we want a complete seamless experience, right? I might be in my laptop sometime, on my phone, sometimes without a device. How do you reach out to me in a relevant manner? And share the value in a way that's meaningful to me. I think that's really what customers seek, is really the whole meaningful interaction. So I'm trying to summarize this in a kind of value equation, saying that the value that you derive to the consumer is the relevance and the timeliness of your action, but keeping in mind the fact that you don't want him to feel that he's losing privacy, right? So never get, in a sense, make a customer uncomfortable. So the whole thing is enveloped in a box of trust. I think that's the key part that customers are seeking. So I have this, a marketoonist, the wonderful cartoon, says it pretty much, right? So here's this lady who says, no, I don't give consent to my personal data. No cookies, no tracking, no browsing history. The less the site knows about me, the better, right? This is what she wants. Hey, but why isn't the shopping experience more personalized? So you'll always have this little dichotomy with customers, right? They want all the privacy, but at the same time, they want that experience personalized. So really, that's how, that's really the dilemma that marketers face. I'll just throw it open to my co-panelists right now. I've introduced them. There's Piyush who's going to go first. He's the head of data platform engineering at MakeMyTrip. We'll have Varun going next from Zoomcar, and then there's Vipul from Gaana who's going to talk a bit. Right? So hand it over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Lloyd, for giving us quick bites on personalization. I'm going to quickly talk about a couple of things which we have done at MakeMyTrip, hopefully some of the learnings which we can share it with the audience here. So thanks for joining me here at Martech. So just to quickly talk about, like, so MakeMyTrip has different line of businesses. So I'm sure most of the audiences would know. like flight, hotels, holiday packages, ground transportation, and then like so my experiences, which is a new line of business which is added. So for our customers, like we want to personalize the whole experience when they are onto the platform and when they are off funnel as well. And the journey to personalization started with like personalizing the experience when the person is there on the app. It means like so when they are there in doing any activity on the funnel. But like so we earlier had disjoint systems which were like so any off-funnel engagement is handled by a marketer talking about some of the campaign related stuff which he wanted to communicate to the users. To unify the whole piece, right? So we built in-house our own CDP and the key pieces. So just talking about like, so what are the key things while doing personalization? So having a customer data platform really helps you do the personalization in the right manner. The relevancy is really important, right? So like understanding the user intent. Earlier, if you have seen ads, et cetera, those were retargeting based on the user recent or last interaction itself. But like understanding the various session chains, like so the activities done by the user, et cetera, is really important for anybody to come onto the platform and do like interact with a good customer experience itself. Then like, so there are good amount of data insights which any organization generate in-house, right? Those insights need to be utilized in form of persuasions, et cetera, and need to integrate it in the right manner on app and while communicating to the user via notifications, et cetera. So I'm going to quickly talk about these things, maybe skipping a couple of slides, but yeah. So talking about the customer data platform, right? So the very key stuff for us was instead of looking at bunch of rows and columns, you need to really treat every customer has its own database with you to understand like what he's doing, his customer journey, et cetera. So we have built an in-house tool called BoulderDB, which integrates like per user databases where I can store like a user journeys and like his profile data, device details and many other pieces related to it. So, and hence like having it in as part of your CDP really helps you nail down to a one-on-one level rather than a cohort level or a segment level itself. The other key piece is the quality of data is really important. So the key is like when you are generating that data or while you are capturing that data, do it in the right manner. And hence like so having the right schema or common data model at the back to capture those event of users really helps you do a good stuff while you are like getting insights out of it or building a customer experience on top of it for the user. The other key pieces, like so most of the stuff is like so you only do gather from the client events, right? So but like there are a lot of information out there at the back with the server side where you can do a lot about, like for example, if you are taking a pricing decision based on if you want to just personalize the price point to a particular person, you have the information about like how it is getting computed at the back. And the other key piece is you need to really do a good job in stream processing to get to a like millisecond performance onto stream processing itself. I'm probably going to skip it. The other key piece is you need to decouple your customer data platform from your use cases with, or the various data products you build on top of it. Be it like if you are building an orchestration layer on top of your CDP for campaign management, etc., this doesn't need to coexist like really like a monolith sitting on top of your customer data platform. And hence, like so, that helps you do a better job at doing the personalization across various channels itself. So that's another key point. Relevancy, as I said, like so you need to really know the user from his past sessions, what he is doing, what he is looking for, and do a right job of communicating with right deep links at, when you are communicating with the user itself. So that is one of the key stuff. Persuasions, like so wherein like so the insights which you are generating, like so 80% of the hotels booked XYZ location, etc., you want to use all those insights to do a better persuasions while communicating to the user. So this is one of the other key piece, other key learnings onto working at like so building some of the stuff. probably. The last thing probably is like, so do, there is no magic wand right there, right? So, which is, you need to do a good amount of experimentation, and while doing experimentation, multi-armed bandit really help you allocate traffic to the right winning experiment which you have configured. So utilize MABs as much as you can while doing experimentation. That really helps you. And the contextual bandit, like, so it's not just the experiment which is winning. You are also passing on the user context or the search history of the user or the actions a user is performing right now to your machine learning models to take out the right decisions. Yeah, that's about it.
Thanks, Piyush. So I think what Piyush attempted to do was really take you through a little bit of the back-end technology involved with how to make the customer experience more personalized. And in a sense, you know, he's the only geek in our panel. So logically, we're going to move to the marketer. But I was talking to Piyush just before we got on. He was talking about how a lot of his time in Make My Trip, he actually spends with the marketing folks in terms of, you know, how do you drive usage, how do you drive, increase loyalty, and, you know, kind of cross-sell and upsell. So really, it's the interface. It's really a lot of the back-end technologies that powers great customer experiences and great marketing. And therefore, it's a logical segue to actually have Varun come on next and share with us his experiences in how he's using personalization in Zoomcar.
Great. Thanks, Lloyd. Thanks, Piyush. Lovely audience. Full pack today. Quick, intro on Zoomcar. Those who are not aware that Zoomcar today is the market leader in the self-drive space, and we have like more than 15,000 cars in our fleet, and we give self-drive cars for rental, to the end customers, and we have a user base of to the north of 20 million, and we have been operating in India for the last 6 years now. So if I could get that device, flip device, sorry. Yeah. Sorry. So yeah, I mean, I will quickly, of course, like Lloyd touched upon personalization, but as a marketeer, what exactly, if I have to, talk in a very fundamental note, like, what is it like? Does it a nicely done, relevant ad copy? Is it about creating bunch of hundreds of taglines, have a lot of creative variants, have very relevant in-app banners or, display banners? I mean, this was quite shocking and troubling, especially for all marketeers. And this little survey was done by eMarketer earlier last year, where most of the CMOs and the marketing heads, they really struggle. Okay, like personalization is a buzzword, and a lot of tech is at play, but how do you actually attack the customer and get the business implications out of it, right? So just wanted to share this, this is actually not Photoshop. This I got from one of my colleagues at work at Zoomcar, and it's a personalized can from Coke. So the moment Coke had their campaign share a Coke campaign, and this really drifted the sales by over 5% in UK when it was introduced in UK. So what exactly, you can see a brand like an FMCG brand doing a lot of personalization stuff where there's a lot of tech play involved. I mean, before jumping, let me skip this in the interest of time. Yeah. So basically, I am fond of saying this, that all of us know, but just to summarize it, actually marketing, if you look at marketing is actually the new finance. I'm sure all of us realize this, right? It's all about numbers. While Piyush was talking, how do you get numbers from different segments, different tables, put it into one place, and then obviously how you make meaningful, actionable insights out of it. So the holy grail, make it very simple for you guys, that the holy grail of personalization today is that having segment of one. So it's no more about target audiences. This is sec A, this is sec B, and especially for us at Zoomcar, this is a holiday road tripper, this is a weekend commuter, or this is a weekday commuter. Nothing like that. If you actually have to make juice out maximum benefits from personalization, you have to create a segment of one. So I need to know who Varun is, what he does, what are his digital footprints, and then what are the data available at my platform, and then how I can obviously target him better. So in order to create, so let us look at this user Vinay. So at Zoomcar, what we look at is that how long he has been my customer, what is his preferred city, where he actually picks a self-drive car. then what sort of customer he is. Champion customer would be someone who has used Zoomcar thrice or probably more than that. Then what is his preferred car, hatchback, sedan, you know, like, and what sort of brand he prefers. What is his destination? What is his preferred destination, right? Where he actually goes. What was his last booking with my platform? And whether, as I said, whether it's a weekday, weekend customer. And then we arrive something called as driver score. Interestingly, we are one brand, since we are into O2O space, while most of the companies, they do a lot of in-app personalization, we do a lot of in-trip personalization. Because for us, the average duration when a customer books a car with Zoomcar, the average booking duration is more than 50 hours, which means for 50 hours, he's inside a car offered by me. And imagine the kind of experiences I can co-curate based on the information or the single view of this customer I have, right? So I will quickly jump to that slide. How do we achieve at that? Is this by using this in-trip personalized recommendation example. So basically, you know, we have an onboard diagnostic tool which is powered by IntelliCar that is placed inside within the car. So it basically tells me the GPS location of the car, the latitude and the longitude. It tells me that this user Vinay, how many turns he is taking. How he's using the car, is he driving, rash driving or not? What is the clutch, what is the brake, what is the acceleration speed? So we use a lot of these onboard diagnostic signals. And since I spoke about single view of the customer, I also have Vinay's lot of marketing data, a lot of user data, so a lot of digital footprints. So for example, I know for a fact that Vinay has been with Zoomcar for 4 years. His preferred location is somewhere, in, say, towards Manesar, and he's starting from Gurgaon, and he loves a lot of KFC burgers. So what exactly I will do is that moment this customer Vinay is actually going, and you know he's like 20 minutes, 15 minutes away, you know, like due to like he's away from this KFC restaurant, I'll throw him a notification. Because I have done an in-trip, I have done an in-app, you know, integration with setups like Highway Delight, Ease My Trip, and these setups, they create co-curated experiences and offers when you're on the move. So moments Vinay is approaching KFC, he will get a push notification saying, okay, hey, by the way, you can get 10% off powered by Zoomcar, powered by Highway Delight. And I know for a fact that Vinay has been using me and loves burgers. So then obviously this user gets really excited by the kind of relevant, you know, in-trip experiences I added. The second example I want to give here is that we are actually in talks with, you know, music streaming player. Of course, we have Vipul from Gaana, but we are in talks with Spotify. So very soon we are going to launch custom playlist. So I know for a fact that if Lloyd is a holiday road tripper, loves going to Ladakh, Leh, and Goa, and can I have a Goa playlist? Can I have a custom playlist like that? So basically what I'm trying to accentuate here is that within the trip, since you have a lot of information of the customer, you can actually co-curate a lot of experiences when the customer is on the move. And how we are actually doing this is actually we use an open source called Kepler. So Kepler is an open source which is used by Grab, which is used by Lyft, which is used by Uber. So basically it's an open source and it has an input from Google Maps API. And over and above, the moment I input my latitude and longitude, real-time signals that I get from the car's OBD system, I can actually tell where this customer is. So this is actually, this map is actually, all the trips originating from Bangalore in real time. And I actually know where this customer is right now, how many times he's stopping. So basically, as a marketer, this helps me in real time taking a lot of optimization decisions that whether I have to throw him an offer or whether I have to tell him, hey, by the way, there's a washroom, probably 10 minutes, from where you are. And if you want to have, obviously go to the loo, you can obviously do that. So yeah, more interesting stuff on that. And this was the marketing stack that I was talking about. So we have car data, we have user data, we have a lot of response data from the IoT device. Then we create a single view of the customer by amalgamating all this information. And obviously, as you can have a lot of analytics and recommendation engine, you can create a lot of offers. So this is an example of an app personalization. So for example, a customer like me, I love a lot of hatchback. I always take the top variant. I always take without fuel. I want the car to be home delivered. I prefer leather seats. I want the car to be scented. So we are launching a service called Zoom Premium, where I know for sure that if these are the things this customer has always preferred on my platform, I can actually monetize on this, and he will love this experience, right? So that is an app personalization example. And this is an example of driver score. So basically, as I said initially, that we create a driver score, and this is the last slide of my presentation today, that we create, just like credit score of, in the credit card world, we have a driver score where we know for the fact that what was the behavior of this driver? Did he pick the car on time? Did he fill the checklist? Hopefully he did not do a rash driving, right? And he maintained the car, dropped the car back in the clean condition. So we create a dynamic score which gives a credibility, which means if you have a high driver score with me, I know for a fact that you're my superpower customer, and I should leave no stone unturned in delivering an amazing experience. Which means if I have to waive off something like a security deposit next time you're booking a car, I will have a differential or a dynamic security deposit. I might even waive it off. So just to summarize this point, the fact is that while all of us, we talk about personalization, we at Zoomcar are actually, doing a lot of path-breaking stuff as far as, entry personalization is concerned, because without which, we just can't sustain the business model, because it's all about delighting the customer, whether he's booking on your app or whether he's interacting with your brand off the road. Thanks. Cheers.
Thanks, Varun. So that is an interesting perspective. I think the thought that he leaves behind is that car rentals are a legacy business. Avis and Hertz have been around for decades. It's how you use personalization to make the driving context and the experience more seamless and interesting, right? While both MakeMyTrip and Gaana are digital-first businesses, car rentals are an old business, and that's really taken. So I think a lot of the challenge of personalization is how are we going to use personalization with existing legacy businesses, the more traditional categories like fast-moving consumer goods and consumer durables, and then make the whole customer experience more seamless. I think that's one of the lessons. I'd like to get Vipul now to kind of share his perspective. Music streaming is a new business. It's changing the landscape of how people consume music, right? We've all seen the eras when we collected vinyls and then CDs and then we downloaded music. I think now it's pretty much, stream as and when you want. But more important over time, I guess everyone in the room has experienced it, how we see that the streaming sites really know our tastes, sometimes better than our spouse, right? What kind of music you want to listen to, what time of day, what do you listen to on your morning jog, what do you listen to on your drive to work, what do you listen to when you're having a low day, and so on and so forth. So we'd love to have Vipul share his perspective. Vipul's from Gaana.
Hi, everyone. I do like the other two panelists.
Everyone's feeling relieved.
I'll just talk about what we do from a larger business standpoint. So Gaana is India's largest and most favorite music streaming app, as you all know. By the way, good luck with Spotify.
We would love to integrate with you as well.
So I'll talk about how we use personalization and on what metrics we try to do that. I mean, Piyush has covered a lot of it from an engineering standpoint. And conceptually, more or less, everyone who is investing in data uses some or the other variant of what Piyush has talked about. So he's covered it well. What I'll talk about is that, we use personalization primarily for three main business goals. One is consumption. What I mean by consumption is content consumption. Second is to marketing, like Varun talked about. And third is monetization. When I say monetization, so Gaana is an ad-supported platform. The marketers who want to use Gaana as a publisher, they need a lot of personalization, like Varun wanted to target a specific customer with a specific behavior. So if he wants to use Gaana as a publisher, he would need a lot of data around my audience, and he would say, hey, Vipul, I need to target only these many audiences so that I can get the maximum bang for my buck that I spend on Gaana, right? Now, I'll talk about the consumption bit first. And how much time do I have?
5 to 7 minutes.
Yes. So I'll see how much we can cover, okay? Because consumption is the most important bit for us, because the whole business is about content. if you get your user to spend more time on the platform, I think the other two goals get taken care of, which is marketing and monetization. Now, on the consumption bit, so when you, I mean, traditionally it was like when you come on a platform like Gaana or any other Netflix, I mean, say 6 years ago, most of the users would, or 4 to 5 years ago, depending on which country you have been looking at. Your first thing is that you come, browse, and figure out what to do, play it, then you search again, and then you figure out what to do next. I mean, that behavior is changing. Users come on the platform, they want me to tell them what they want, right? And they expect the platform to figure out what the user would like. So today, if my personalization used to drive X of my consumption, say 2 years ago, today it at least drives 20 to 25X of my content consumption on the platform. So today, if you come on Gaana and consume music, let's say as a new user, you have come on Gaana, consume music for the first session, which may last around 20 to 30 minutes, which is about 5 to 6 songs, depending on the songs that you're listening and how often you're skipping them. I would know a lot about you in that session. And the next session that you come, the first song that you listen, I mean, the song that you listen post the first song, rather, you wouldn't need to feel like browsing or searching. I mean, we'll push you songs that you like, and you won't feel bad about it. So what we do, we look at metrics like the simpler metrics like the era of the song that you have listened to, the playback artist of the song that you have listened to, the actors in the song that have been involved, the language of the song, and then more complex attributes like the genre of the song. Genre is a very complex attribute, by the way. I'll talk about it if I get time. And then the waveform attributes of the song, right? Like the acoustics of the song, the treble of the song, the bass of the song. And then we push you those songs based on your listening pattern. And personalization has generally two goals for a content consumption platform. One is to, you know, let the user get what he wants. And from a business standpoint, I would want the user to discover as much content as possible. Because, you know, browsing in general helps you discover content because you're browsing and figuring out what you want and stuff like that. But as in when we have evolved over the past 2-3 years, users don't want to browse. But at the same time, they want me to give them content which they haven't heard but they like. So that is where the discoverability angle has to be taken care of in the personalization algorithms that we do. So let's say if you have heard a song, let's say a party song, which is from 2018, and 10 minutes later you may get a song which is from 2000s, but it still has the same set of beats, same set of waveform attributes, and you won't even feel like you've heard a song from 2000. So that is what determines the success of personalization on a music streaming platform from a content consumption standpoint. Now, talking about waveform attributes and content, you know, we invest a lot in content. Now, gone are the days when I'll say, "Ha, ye song achha lag raha hai, ab khareed lo." I mean, it cannot be done that way anymore. I mean, because the content is very expensive. So we look at the waveform attributes of the song and figure out what's going to be a hit in future. Like, what works on my platform? What does audience on Gaana like? What kind of song do they like? And then we figure out, okay, how much to invest in a particular piece of content that has come on our table, right? So these are the large, broad parameters on which we drive consumption. I mean, I can go on and on, and you know, Piyush has obviously talked about, the last thing was that, you know, how it is very important to keep experimenting and keep tweaking your algorithms so that, you know, you are in tune with your users. You know, user habits change very frequently. You like one music today, you don't like I used to like Madhuri Dixit 10 years ago, I like Katrina Kaif today. So, you know, so those patterns have to be taken care of and the algorithms have to be figured out. Like say in Telugu and Tamil, your data may tell you that, you know, people like to listen to songs based on the actors in the song. But in Hindi, the data may tell you that people like to listen to songs based on the playback artists in the song. So these things are very, very important when driving consumption on the platform through personalization algorithms. One algorithm need not work for every user on the platform or every language and stuff like that. I'll quickly come to the monetization bit and then I'll hand over the mic to Lloyd. So on the monetization bit, one of the so we all know about, you know, how Google has made dynamic display ads and, you know, how that ads get created on the fly based on the data of the user. I mean, data could be all sorts of data depending on the context you are looking at. Now, from a music streaming platform, given that most of the marketers' budget has been spent on radio, if we have to attract those budgets and say, I have to show them audio ads, you know, because a user on Gaana spends what, I think 60 to 70% of his time in the background, like on the headphone, and maybe 30 to 35% of the time on the screen. So if I have to monetize the platform, which is ad supported, I have to show them audio ads in a very, very targeted fashion. If I have to divert the radio budgets from a marketer to a music streaming platform. So the audio ads, we have been working on highly dynamic audio ads where we look at, you know, various parameters of the user on the platform and then serve an audio ad to you, which would, where the creative gets created on the fly, and then it's, you know, the success rate of that ad or the recall value of that is a lot higher. So let's say a Swiggy wants to advertise on the platform, I would look at what time of the day it is, what temperature it is outside where the user is, I'll use his location parameters, and then I'll serve him an ad talking about a specific beverage or a food which is in line with these parameters that I just talked about. So those are the dynamic audio ads that we work on. Then we are working on voice activated ads where we use a lot of artificial intelligence to talk to the user, and it becomes almost conversational. I mean, we'll be releasing them soon. We are already doing beta in-house for those voice activated ads. Yeah, so that's it, Lloyd.
Yeah. Thanks, Vipul. I think interesting. You can sit down. I think we'll just spend the next 5-odd minutes talking through a couple of key issues pertaining to personalization. I think the first part, which you know, each of you can, you know, if you can answer in less than a minute, is really a lot of personalization is really data that sits on your platform. In the context of Gaana, it's, you know people's usage patterns, you know what they listen to in the first few listenings, and over time, you know, kind of in a sense, machine learning kind of refines this whole technique and comes good. Is there some degree of fertilizing data from other sources without kind of infringing on people's privacies? In the context of Gaana, you know every morning, possibly on my way to work, I listen to Coldplay, and in the evening, you know, I want more soulful stuff, so I listen to Mukesh or Mohammed Rafi. So you kind of get a sense of my music patterns. While my conversations on social media, on Twitter, I might be, you know, going ballistic over Mika. How is it that you can use data from different sources, say from social footprints, to make the experience more enlightening and more seamless?
Yeah, so we look at a lot of trending data on alternative consumption platforms like YouTube, and I cannot not talk about TikTok these days, and then use these macro data to feed into our personalization algorithm. So if I have to push a playlist, which is a trending playlist to a user, it won't just be based on his consumption on data. To aid discovery for my business, and I have to consume these data points around me on other platforms and then push a trending playlist to the user. You know, so the trending on my platform is very different from a trending on YouTube or a trending on TikTok.
In fact, just to add to what he's saying, I mean, the lines, actually, you have to be a little bit cautious, because lines becomes a little bit blurred because it might be a breach of privacy. Sure. So for a fact, I know if someone is logging to Zoomcar or any app for that matter, he can log in through Facebook, he can have a Truecaller login, he can have a Google login. And for sure, I know these apps do a lot of listening. They have a lot of data available. So, I mean, it's obviously a matter of ethics as well, that how to what extent or what degree kind of information, because user has not opted for that data. Because it's written very minusculely somewhere on your app or on a website that when you log in through Truecaller or Facebook, we'll pass your information, right? So, I mean, the biggest example is the Face app, that went viral, right? Because they said that we'll have free royalty not to use your pic in whatsoever shape and form that we want. So that's the biggest breach of privacy as well.
So at any point of time, we don't use user-specific data to push them trending playlists, just to clarify. So we don't breach any privacy. I mean, we have reached a good enough scale to breach any sort of privacy. And those basics are always taken care of.
The other part, and you know, I want to get this to Piyush, is the whole issue of using data to actually direct consumers into slightly more profitable avenues, right? So in the context of, let's say, a travel booking site, you know this guy is a regular booker of you want him over time to use hotels or to use, self-drive cars and such like. So to what extent does harnessing data help in behavior shaping, right? So if I'm an office guy, I know one of my team colleagues, you know, always makes last minute bookings, knowing fully well that the flight will be booked out and he might get bumped up to business class. So do you all enable a certain degree of behavior shaping patterns that can be used?
Yeah, absolutely, and everybody does it. Cross-sell, upsell are the old keywords to do it. But in our case, primarily, whenever somebody is coming onto our platform and searching for something, be it for flight travel or holiday package or anything, right? So we create a pseudo itinerary, right? That pseudo itinerary may not have searched or done anything onto our platform with respect to other line of businesses or other offerings or other products which we have onto our platform. But at the back, for me to do a recommendation, right? What is it going to be a hotel with which star category and other pieces which we want to recommend it to you to get a more wallet share from you and those kind of things? Definitely that helps us not just on the business side of it, but fulfilling the user requirement as well. Because on a trip, when I am creating a pseudo itinerary, I am trying to predict, what all your needs are. So it's a win-win situation, both from consumer end, right, where I am trying to help him build the itinerary, based on the recommendations which I am curating onto the platform. The other is, on the monetization side of it, we get that particular point.
Okay, so just broad-basing this into a slightly broader question. So for the various businesses and brands, so therefore, is there the equivalent of a war room, right? So if I have to get better customer experience, do I need to get, a data scientist, a technologist, a marketeer, a consumer insight specialist together, and then brief them? So how would, for example, Zoomcar and Gaana look at creating this kind of marketing agility?
I think that's a fantastic question. Basically, as you rightly said, it's a war room. So having a great data engineering is mission critical because you need to have clean data in one place. Then on top of data engineering, you will have data decision sciences who will tell that while this is the data from different tables, what are the actionable insights? And they will give you actionable insights. They will not own the business implications. And there where you have consumer research specialists and marketing specialists, they will say, okay, if this customer has these many variables and attributes, now I can have what layers of monetization keeping the customer experience intact. So yeah, to your point, it's kind of a very well-oiled assembly line, which or probably a war room, if you have to say that everyone has an equally important role to play. But you just can't discount data. As I said, marketing is the new finance, right? Data is at the epicenter of it.
And to what extent did this happen in Gaana?
I mean, everything is very, very data-driven. So these days, be it marketing, be it, I mean, the best guy to hire is a full stack data scientist who can code as well. So
one of the key things, just to add, apart from people and the skill set, you need to build or invest onto the right platforms as well. So the right tools and platforms which can self-serve or help those fellows who are working on it really helps throughout the
journey.
Yeah,
at scale, that becomes very important.
Yeah.
Okay, so great. I think we've covered a broad swathe of things pertaining to personalization. I think the one point that most speakers reinforced, but I think we all need to remember, is the whole fine line between customization and privacy. To what extent do you go to data mine customers' data outside of your platforms to layer it on? to make more enlightened decisions, to shape behavior, that doesn't violate on individual customers' privacy. And increasingly, that's going to be, you know, a big watch out, right? While policy on this is still evolving at a macro framework, the reality is, as business decision makers, we all need to watch out for that. So that pretty much closes our panel discussion. I don't know if you have time for just one or two audience questions, if there are any, and thereafter we'll wind up. So if anyone's got an audience question, you can stand up, raise your hand, identify yourself, and say your bit.
Hi, my name is Sunil Sharma. As a marketer, I have a question, you know, how do I invest? Because if I advertise on any platform, you know, I'm a roadblock to his entertainment. So he feels very irritated. It doesn't happen on a TV. When we interact with the consumer, they say ki TV pe to chalta hai. But when we are on this thing and we see any advertisement, it's the irritant. So how do I invest more over here?
I think that's a great question. So basically, a vanilla advertising will not fit the bill here, because when I was speaking, I mean, you have to co-curate experiences. If I have a custom playlist for that person, right, and I can monetize on over and above of that. Second example, I was talking about that you can have, whether when you're using, say, something like Zoomcar, and within the trip you have, you know, tied up with all the restaurants on the highway, right, and then you can throw offers. So basically, where I'm coming from is that if you're going to show him a random ad about a biscuit, right, that will not fit the bill, right? You're just spamming your customer. It's a very, very bad customer experience, right? So point is that you have to go deeper into content and you have to co-curate the experience. Otherwise, you will see that the native advertising, basically the platform that you're using, they will see high amount of uninstalls happening.
Can it be co-created between two of them?
Absolutely, it has to be. That is why, like, before this discussion started, I mean, I was just having a quick chat with, you know, Vipul, and we are also, like, quite eager to, you know, launch something like Gaana playlists on Zoom app. So app-in-app integration. Otherwise, you're just spamming your customers.
We've got severe time constraints. We'll have to hold it to just one last question. I think Zubin's waving his hand.
Hi. Can you hear me, guys? Yeah. I'm Zubin from Shemaru Entertainment. We've just launched our OTT app, Shemaru Me. The question to all three of you is, where does video play a role in engagement and personalization for all your businesses?
I think all three of us have to talk one by one. Or?
Yeah, it'll help.
It's got less than 30 seconds because we're really under time. So 30 seconds. Go.
Yeah, go ahead.
So if you have been following Gaana, so we recently launched video on our platform 2 months ago. So we do two formats of video. One is short format and one is the whole video of the song. So, you know, one of the objectives is to get the user to, at least being a music OTT app, one of the objectives is to get the user to spend more and more time on the foreground rather than on the headphone. So that way, video is getting more and more engagement on the video, helps us meet that goal. Because, you know, why we do that? We say because audio ads are yet to take off in India, and, you know, rest of the ads formats which are in the foreground, they do better. So the more the user spends time in the foreground, the better it is for us. And video can play a very important role there. Obviously, there are video has a very different sort of licensing issues when compared to music, but that is something how it is doing for us.
I think just to summarize, you can't ignore video. 80% of internet traffic by 2020 is all video, right?
Hang on.
So, yeah, there you go.
Okay, that's pretty much it. I'll hand it back to RMC.